Hello, anatomy friends. This is Dr. Alsup, and welcome to station number 4, which is the last station regarding the bones of the upper limb. So we are finishing with the distalmost bones of the wrist and the hand, so those carpal bones, metacarpals, and phalanges. And during this conversation, we'll also look at the joints that are associated with these, the wrist and the hand. So starting with the carpal bones, these are going to be the ones that are shaded in different colors here. And I'm going to circle the proximal row. This is the row that is going to articulate with the radius. And this right here is going to be the distal row. And these are articulating with the metacarpals. So you will have 4 bones per row. And the only one that you are going to have to identify is this lateralmost bone in the proximal row, which is your scaphoid. This is the most clinically relevant of the carpal bones because it's most commonly fractured, and we talked about how avascular necrosis can occur in the lectures here. So that is going to be the lateralmost in the proximal row. But just for fun, let's go through the other ones just so you get to kind of go through them together. So this is going to be the lunate. This is the trichetrum. And this is the pisiform. The pisiform is that sesamoid bone that's sitting right on top of the trichetrum. The pisiform will form within that flexor carpi ulnaris tendon. So this is from lateral to medial. And I know this is lateral because you can really tell this is the first digit here. It doesn't have an intermediate phalange. The bones are just a little bit stouter, but also shorter. So we know we're looking at the first digit. And first digit when you're in anatomical position is always lateral. Hopefully we're getting that down by this point. When we're looking at the distal row from lateral to medial, you'll have the trapezium, the trapezoid, so I'll put a TR here. Then we have the capitate and the hamate. So again, the only one that you have to identify for a practical setting will be the scaphoid, but I just wanted to put these in here just in case you wanted to kind of go through them with me. Now, one thing I want to talk about regarding the carpal bones is the carpal tunnel. And we talked a little bit about clinically why that is relevant, but I wanted to show you this area. And the carpal tunnel is going to be formed by the carpal bones, which are going to be the floor of the carpal tunnel. And you can't see that in this image because we also have the roof of the carpal tunnel, which is the transverse carpal ligament, sometimes referred to as the flexor retinaculum. And so that's going to completely occlude the view of the carpal bones when present. And it's been removed here, but recall that we're going to have tendons that are going to be traveling through the carpal tunnel from the anterior compartment of the forearm, or the flexor compartment, as well as that median nerve, which is also going to be in there. And surrounding those tendons will be the tendon sheaths that can become inflamed in a form of bursitis, which can lead to pinching of that median nerve. So that is what leads to carpal tunnel syndrome. Okay, back to the bones and the joints. So there are those carpal bones. This that is shaded in light orange are going to be your metacarpals. And your metacarpals are going to form that skeleton of the palm of the hand. And recall that we number these 1 to 5 from lateral to medial. So this would be the first metacarpal, the second, third, fourth, and fifth. Now you can see that these, the distal row of the carpal bones are going to articulate with the metacarpals, or that more proximal end of the metacarpals. And these would be the CMC, or carpometacarpal joints. The CMCs 2 through 5 are going to be examples of plane joints, but recall that this joint right here between the first metacarpal and the trapezium is going to form a saddle joint, which is capable of more movements than you have in these other carpometacarpal joints. Okay, the joint between the metacarpals and the proximal phalanges are going to be your metacarpophalangeal joints. So between the distal end of the metacarpals and the proximal end of the proximal phalanges are going to be your MP joints, and these are examples of condyloid joints. Okay, so shaded in pink are going to be your proximal phalanges. Shaded in kind of a light purple are going to be your middle phalanges or intermediate phalanges. And notice that you do not have an intermediate phalange associated with the first digit. You only have proximal and distal. And so these light blue are going to be your distal phalanges. This whole complex right here of the first digit is often referred to as the pollex. And you'll have a hallux associated with the big toe of the foot. So the joint between the proximal phalange and the intermediate phalange are going to be your PIP joints. So you'll have those across the board here. And then the joint between the intermediate and the distal phalanges will be your DIP joints, which I'm going to kind of draw a line through those. This particular joint right here in the first, since you don't have the intermediate, is just referred to as the interphalangeal joint. All right, and those PIPs and DIPs, as well as this interphalangeal joint, will be examples of hinge joints, so only capable of flexion and extension. Excellent, so those are the bones of the upper limb. So let's get into some of the specific joints in this region, and then we'll move on to muscles. Thanks for your time and attention here, and always feel free to reach out with any questions.